we're going to cover a sort of run through of our talk, which Emma and I will sort of interrupt each other on, a sort of introduction to what we've been doing, then handling in the packaging, which was a huge part of the project, and the sort of leading on to the storage, and then a sort of brief run through the sort of description, which hopefully doesn't overlap with Jerry's, but obviously will to some extent, the condition and the conservation sort of wrapped up in one. And then the analysis of the polychromy, which Emma will cover, which has been a large part of the sort of taking samples. And then our sort of loose recommendations, which will be a work in progress, I think, for the future of the project. But as a sort of basic background, as Jerry has done, actually I've just got to rewrite this already from what he said, as the timeline starts, I had circa 1400, but Jerry's finding that it's more 1440, so they were, as you know, constructed much closer together than we had previously conceived. And then we have the construction of the south transept Reredos in the sort of 1470s. Then they disappeared from sight for 300 years until the Reformation in 1848, and then there was a flurry of interest, and that's where the sort of conservation, if you like, from the sort of destruction of them, and then the conservation issues began, both positive and negative, as sort of records have said, that from the start they were, as Judith said initially, the church community really, really was very zealous in looking after them and trying to maintain them, which is can be seen today as a huge testament to the fact that they're not, they are so unusual and so important because they haven't been overpainted. So a sort of run through the various conservators who've been involved, particularly around the 80s, which we have provided us an invaluable resource to work from today, and sort of which we've hopefully built on a little. So our brief was to inspect the two frameworks, but a sample area of the two frameworks as a whole, and also a sample of the fragments of the sculpture. We haven't had the luxury yet to look at all of the fragments, so sort of findings a general approach at this, you know, based on the sort of a generalization of the conditions that we've found. And so our knowledge is far, far from that Jerry has gleaned in building up the sort of greater picture. We are just focusing on the condition and the conservation. The paint analysis was a huge part of our brief of taking samples, which Emma will deal with later. And then our report, which is outlining the condition and then how to approach the conservation of that to preserve them as they are. And so to stop the deterioration, and as you know, with the storage, so much of that's the biggest intervention that's happened since they've been, well, since they were actually created, I suppose. I was going to say since they were rediscovered, but that's the most important thing, and the most important thing that could happen is what has been achieved over this summer by the whole team. And then we'll go into that a little bit more, and then the presentation of those findings as well. So to go back to just refresh you, in case you've forgotten after Jerry's wonderful illustration, we have the north and we have the south Reredoses and the sort of wide view as they are today. Where obviously since the Reformation everything was simplified, you know, the church would have been a much busier, visually busier place than we see today. You know, things have been whitewashed, and that's our taste still overriding, you know, today in very many of our churches, whereas there would have been so much more sort of gold and colour and the figures there. So once again, we have the North Reredos and the South Reredos, and we can see, so this is how they are today. The fragments that we have looked at and trying to decide, you know, sort of, you know, architectural elements, figurative elements, elements that might not belong to either North or South Reredos, and trying to sort of work to build up that picture of their condition, of their requirements, and where they may have come, and whether they can be put back together, or, you know, sort of that's an open-ended question on how to present them for the future.
This is where I take over.
There we go, that's great, thank you. It's got lost there.
As soon as Lynne starts glazing over like that, I know it's my turn to take over. So if you start seeing me do the same, it'll be about the right time. We have a certain attention span. Hopefully that way we'll keep you all awake as well. As Lynne said, one of the initial tasks for us was to look at the storage and the packaging and the environment that the framework and the fragments were in, and to offer advice and training seminars for all the individuals, the volunteers, the people that were going to come into contact with those fragments. This collection, the framework, the sculptural elements, the pieces that we've got, they form an incredible collection of sort of unrivaled medieval artefacts, and the extent of the polychromy as well. It's important that, you know, if something happens to them now, we've learnt so much about them that the condition that they're in now is sort of slightly, over the years since they were uncovered, has deteriorated. It's really important that we start to address the environment that they're in so that we can, if not completely prevent, sort of slow down and halt and take measures to improve the conditions that they're in. Once lost, then they're irreplaceable. And I mean, that's something that conservators here will know. This is part of what drives us, is, you know, so much of our history gets lost over time. It's important that we look after it. And when we can, we take certain measures. There are lots of environmental factors, such as the light, temperature, humidity that we can control. But we also, initially focusing on the fragments themselves, thinking about their environment, the fact that the project involved this extensive cataloguing, they needed to be moved, they needed to be repackaged and placed into a better store. So part of our seminar involved teaching about moving equipment. It was very hands-on. We had a bit of a giggle as well. It wasn't so dry. But assessing the different fragments, the big ones, the small ones, the delicate ones, the ones that had a lot of polychromy. And then again, talking about when you move something, thinking ahead, assessing the route. They're all fairly standard aspects of thinking about handling and moving, but they're important things to consider. Hopefully now that the work's been done, we have this catalogue and the items are now safe, that we, you know, the main aim is so that we're not handling, because over the years these fragments have moved around a bit. They've been over to the cathedral, they've been back, they've been, you know, moved within the church itself, and the storage where they were initially, the environment wasn't fantastic. So, you know, we want to get to a point now where we can just sort of, you know, we know they're safe. And you know, until such a time that conservation work can be undertaken, and then we can consider display as a possible final conclusion. We needed to think about the materials that we were using. The fragments, we tend to think of stone, it's quite robust, it's fairly sort of inert, it's not going to you know, be much of a problem, we can do pretty much what we want with it. Well, that to some degree is true compared to a lot of other materials, but of course we then have the question of the polychromy, and this very sensitive polychromy. The organic materials that are used are very, very much influenced by the environment. Our choice of materials that we chose were the boxes. They were plastic, quite rigid, hard boxes. They're made with inert polycarbonate. They have lids. All of this is going to act as a sort of buffering zone for any environmental fluctuations that might be present within their storage system. We've used acid-free tissue and plastazote. It was important, you'll see from some images that I've got later, that the items needed to be able to be in a box container displayed in such a way that you could see all of them. So we created little puffed nests. I think When later on during the week where we were at the museum in the summer, and Lynne and I got the chance to actually see the boxes again and see them open and see the fruits of all our kind of diktat from before, it was ever so encouraging to see them beautifully displayed. The nests were created and individual, the smaller fragments were held in place. Again, you could use the tissue in such a way that you can support vulnerable edges, but at least it means that with the information written on the outside of the boxes, with all the cataloguing numbers and the contents, it's easy for us now to find the fragments and open them up, if necessary, inspect them. We'll have this record of the condition in some instances, and that's it. The lid can be put on back on, and they can be put back on the shelf, and we don't need to be concerned about their future in that sense. As I said, the environment is very important, particularly with regards to the polychromy. I mean, temperature, as far as stone is concerned, and everything I'm talking about will, in essence, not just be the fragments. I'm talking about the framework as well. And of course, because of that, I'm talking about the environment in the church. Now, churches are notoriously difficult environments to control. They're old buildings. They often have old sort of Victorian heating systems. Sometimes they work very well, sometimes not so well. Of course, you've got the impact of the people coming to use the church for the services or events. This fluctuates all the time, and this has an impact on the environment in the church, that it will increase temperature, lower it, the humidity changes. What we're trying to aim is a sort of a minimal fluctuation. See, most materials can withstand these variations to some degree. I mean, even some of the most sensitive materials, you know, this variation of a few degrees within the norm of, say, for the relative humidity of 50%, you know, a certain amount of swelling, contracting, that can be contained within the material. But once you start to get extreme variations, then you start to get irreversible effects on the materials. So we want to try and reduce that. Temperature, I mean, again, it's finding that compromise, because the temperature for the objects in the storeroom, we can control it, and to some extent, when people are going up into the store, they know what to expect. They know they're going into the store, they know the store is for the fragments, and that's that. So if it's a bit chilly, then it's not going to be an issue. However, within the church itself, then it's finding a balance. It's always finding a compromise. I mean, if possible, something like a sort of 20 degree, which, to be honest, in the house I live in at the moment, that's quite nice. So a sort of balance of temperature, again, without those fluctuations, is what we're aiming for. High temperatures, you know, with paint surfaces, they can become tacky and soft. I mean, this obviously hasn't happened in this environment, but they can then attract dust and can settle. But when you get the humidity, the relative humidity altering as well, then the plasticity of the different paint films can vary, and they can become embrittled, they can dry out, become powdery, and you'll see some examples of where this has happened. Light is quite an issue, particularly with polychromy. Luckily, stone is one of the few materials that's, you know, but not affected by light. But the polychromy, on the other hand, it's quite an issue. And unfortunately, it's also an extremely difficult thing to control. And we can't have the blackout blinds in the church. Again, so it's finding that balance. Again, with light, very difficult, because it's not just a case of reducing the intensity. We think of UV light as being particularly difficult, particularly dangerous to the polychromy. But even a small level of relatively safe light over a long period of time is dangerous to the artifacts. So it's cumulative. But in a sense, any reduction, any variation, is going to improve the situation. there are such things as UV films and that can be placed on windows. Unfortunately, as you saw from the picture earlier, the two frameworks sit right next to massive windows, and obviously the one on the south, particularly an issue with the south, with the intensity of light coming through there. The UV films have come a long way in the last 15, 20 years. Before, you had to keep an eye on them, you had to check the film, check whether they were working. They didn't have a very long life. It tended to be about 5 years or so, but now they're much better and it's sort of 15, 20 years. But again, you still need to be monitoring. Monitoring has been a big part of this project as well. We've placed data loggers within the church. But the data loggers will give us the information about the humidity levels, the temperature, but on its own is not the be-all and end-all. We need other information with it, so it's important that the church is able to keep records of the events that are happening, so you can tell when the people are coming into the church, when perhaps the heating is turned up. They will all, because if you see a sudden spike in your data, unless you know that they're possibly is a very good explanation, then it's not a very useful reading. So you need all this added data, weather conditions as well. It's possible to get the historic meteorological information too, and you can tie that all in together. Again, mechanical damage is an issue, and that's where the handling side of things comes in. Stone will break when it's dropped, and so we need to be very careful that there are certain controls in place for handling the objects. As far as the environment of the store is concerned, we want to try and keep the dust and pollutants down. The boxing system that we've created will act as a buffering system, and so will protect the objects. They're already covered in quite an accumulation of dust and grime over the years. And as Lynne will explain later when we show pictures of the different conditions that we discovered, this doesn't help the situation. You want to keep your objects away from the any kind of open window, any extremes of heating or air conditioning. Okay, Lynne's going to now take over and look in a little bit more detail at the condition that we found on the frameworks first and then some of the fragments.
Okay, so general condition of the north framework. This is, again, using Wheatley's original drawing, but you can see the sort of general outline of the cracks, and it was our sort of recording system, sort of which niched as an easy reference key. And the sort of beige areas are the losses that were recorded initially. So sort of general cracks around. The light grey is the render that's been a repair that's been applied since the opening up in the 1848. So the general problems, what I'll talk about is the, along with the condition, is our sort of brief outline. No conservation has been done at this stage. We were just looking at possibilities for conservation, so trials will still have to be done as part of another phase to establish the exact mixes, and the materials to use. So this is sort of an outline conservation proposal based on the conditions that we've found. So you can see the sort of heavy soiling, the sort of dust and that's on the surface of the polychromy. And one interesting thing, which based on, I think it was a comment possibly on, based on the Wheatley drawings of the illustrations which were coloured early on, is that, and it might have been Helena that said this first, in the 80s when the fragments were looked at, that the polychromy seems to have been, so much of it has lost since it was uncovered. And so certainly this is true, but it might be, hopefully, to put a sort of optimistic look at this, that we don't see as much because it is so discoloured. And when it was first opened up and exposed, the colours were bright, and it was reported that they were as bright as the day they may have been painted. And with the heating systems during the sort of 19th century and sort of possibility of candles burning and sort of atmospheric dirt, that colour would have dulled really rapidly. So maybe with the conservation we'll have a lot more than we think there is, potentially. So we have the soiling, and so there'll be cleaning and solvent trials to establish the most appropriate method of cleaning or dry cleaning, which can bring back some of that colour and then consolidating that. And again, there were sort of drip marks down. There's sort of, you can see where there's a lot of, on the far right there, there's a sort of mildewy in growth from accumulated dirt and then attracting moisture, and the sort of humidity would be affecting that. So we have, yeah, sort of heavy build-up, heavy drips, mildew, cracks opening up, aside from the sort of destruction that went on. Oh, that's the sort of new stone. So that was put on in the Victorians. You can see already how soiled and sort of blended in with the older work because of the sort of ambient dirt that's landed on that. Yeah, and the colours of the pigments have changed there. The little rosettes aren't as they originally were. And the sort of heavy build-up again on the ledges. And the top niche that is higher up on the Reredos, and then the lower one is very, very much darker and heavier soiling on the surface. So we'll be establishing ways to clean that and sort of bring it back up, not to a new state at all, but just to sort of find a balance across. So the Reredos, the aim would be to make it read better as a whole, so you can appreciate the colour and the balance, but not in any way to make it look new again. And then we have cracks, there's opening up, there's actually opening up along a lot of the joints and movement, but actually this does look historic and none of this looks recent. It didn't feel that anything was at imminent risk of collapse or anything like that. So I think all the opening up, the pointing is missing. So relatively simple procedures to put a sympathetic pointing back in that will stabilise those areas and stop any further movement. But if there is ongoing movement that isn't detected now, they also would act as a telltale to, if they open up, to be able to monitor future movement without any major intervention. So the conservation sort of can have a long-term effect, but monitoring will be something that will always be required. And any fills that you do design to put in, you make them weaker than the original, so they are actually sacrificial in effect, so they can be replaced and you wouldn't be replacing any of the original material. So any conservation can be replaced as is needed, and not, you don't expect to do it to necessarily last forever or outlive the object. It's supposed to be sort of weaker and take secondary place to the artifact. What else do we have in the way of issues? Some of the cracks are across the worked face in places, and you can see the paint loss across the cracks, adjacent to the cracks. And other seams that have opened up there along the original joints, and that illustrates very well on the right there the sort of subtle movement where the line of, you know, they would have been built perfectly, you know, they had the skills to make these beautifully, and that when the lines have moved, that's wouldn't have been the original intention. But unless it, you know, there's no way that we would necessarily line that up, there's no argument to do that. You can read it and it's stable. This is along joints again, where we can see cement and mortar spills. Some of that might have been spilt across from when it was panelled, when the panelling went in front of it, and there's mortar that might have gone through from that point. And some of it is repairs since it was exposed in the Victorian period. And then we have a sort of crack where there's sort of a pressure down from sort of fracture in the stone. What else have we got? These, there's dowels, so with the ferrous fixings in there, and as you're aware, when iron corrodes, it expands and can cause further problems, but you wouldn't necessarily move these, would have been medieval fixings, but this is on the niches in the mid-tier of the Reredos, and the iron dowels came out and they supported the pinnacles of the canopy beneath. So the sort of extravagant architectural features of the canopy that was moved away had actually iron dowels coming out from the rear wall just to support the fine ends, and that's the remnants of those. There is actually another image where the finial is still there, but the bit beneath it is it's sort of hanging, and so that's sort of an important aspect to keep with the iron work. What other? Oh, here we go. Yes, so these are the top right one is where the support structure for the finial, and you just see the finial pushed back against the rear face of the Reredos when it would have been out in front over the canopy originally. And then these lines, which would have had the lead, as Jerry pointed out, the techniques that were used to construct these, and potentially the lead poured in. So there's evidence there, and although it's unsightly like that at the moment, it's all part of its story. So my argument would be, who are we to take that away? Even though it's redundant now, it's still part of its history and its story, and it's an original fixing. Then a render was put in on the back, this sort of new render, and the back faces of the niches. And it would be wonderful to explore that. There's no strong argument structurally to necessarily remove it, because it's not as such doing any harm, but it would be very interesting from the historical perspective, and it might be that there's some original material, original decoration behind there, particularly lower down within the niches. This is the Victorian, the reassembling of the archer, the top of the Reredos, and you can see the join between the original work where the polychromy reaches up to, and then the new work that the Victorians put in to help read, so it looked less of a ruin, if you like, I suppose. And you can see how soiled that has come in the short time that that's been there. And it sort of, there's sort of hints that I have to talk to Jerry a little bit more about that, that it sort of looks unfinished as well, and yet that is the Victorian work, as if there was potentially something else planned or they've changed their minds along the way. The left-hand one here shows the render on the lower niches, and again, that's the bit I was referring to, where you can see the sort of tracery, the blind tracery design would have possibly come back down behind the figures. But we don't know. It'd be lovely to have a little delve and find out a bit more of those, and see if there is still the original material behind. And if not, put something a little bit more sympathetic back that would read better, perhaps. And then, yes, we sort of have part repairs from the Victorian times over. That doesn't look like it's over. It's hard to tell on the image, but it's over the polychromy, where it's just a sort of mortar that's spilt down. And again, the sort of simple interventions to remove those. The polychromy itself, or the paint surface, is coming away. It's in some areas you could just breathe on it and it comes off. In other areas, it's very well adhered, and so we'd be looking at sort of the least interventions possible, but just to consolidate that, to make sure no more is lost around the edges of all of the islands of polychromy. And that would go hand in hand with the cleaning. It's impossible to do one without the other, really, but it would lift them enormously. Here we can see, Emma will elaborate on this, on the layers of the polychromy from our analysis, but the yellow colour actually was a ground for another gold layer, but it's also over an earlier gilding. And so in its short life, there are a couple of decorative schemes here, even though it wasn't in existence. So it might be once the South Reredos was built, they decided to just, even though this one had only been around for sort of 30, 40 years, to give a little spruce up at that point. But so we have several layers in amongst the dirt. And the painting wasn't particularly... It was a, what would you say, it was sort of a, they applied it with great care, But it was also an overall effect they were trying to achieve. So close to, it's sort of a bit more like theatre, if you like. And there were carefully drawn lines to mark out where these sort of the stripes would go down with the little foil at the top. And often they missed those careful marking out lines entirely, which was quite interesting to see. Or the colour would change partway down. It would be black at the top and they'd swap to red at the bottom. And on here you can sort of make out on the front of the shaft where they've gilded over the top of some of those lines. And again, on this side there's gilding. It's hard actually with the shadow. It looks as if it's in reverse, the paint's over the gilding. But here the gilding is actually over the paint. And you can just make out, whoops, sort of on this line, the black here. And then the gold is over the top, and again on the other side where they have redecorated. Again, we wouldn't necessarily touch that. There's no argument to do that, but just to preserve it as it is would be sort of our recommendation at this stage. Oh, here, those are clearer of those lines to on the decoration and how it's applied. And then the trefoil, and then the IHC, which is in the central niche at the top of the North Reredos, and again we've got the mildew that's accumulating on the dirt on the surface, which all adds to the sort of the visual integrity of it, as well as ongoing sort of changing of the surface. These are beautiful little the sort of around the canopy levels further back on the framework, and there's the little heads. They're only sort of 15 mil, 20 mil high, the little heads at the bottom, it's like label stops. And I think, what did we even think about? Oh, that shows the size of them, like little grotesques. It's covered, and there were about 150 of those over it, which you just don't observe from ground level, and just the detail that went into there. So anyway, it's sort of a frivolous thing not to do with conservation as such. And then the Jesse Reredos, the same, similar issues. We have the sort of cracks, not so widespread cracks, although the nature in which it was destroyed left far greater open voids with rubble in behind. So it's about consolidating the sort of core elements there, finding out what was part of the original, what's been sort of shoved in there in the intervening years. Lost in a similar way, in that the canopies are lost and we don't have the sort of pedestal, sort of niche plinths in the same way on this one at the lower level. But so similar losses, similar sort of cracking, similar soiling. The back has been lime washed on these ones, so we don't know exactly how the backs of the niches would have read. And as Jerry pointed out, you know, there's sort of been major changes with this, with the window being adjusted, and then the sort of evidence of the lintel and the vine has been adjusted at the low level and high level around the windows. But we've got the soiling, we've got the sort of breaking up of the slate, which would have been used as spacers. Actually, it was on the north we found an oyster shell as well, which was used as a spacer, which is often found in, and sometimes in medieval period in the painting, they found that oyster shells have been used as little palettes for the painting, and then put in with as a spacer, or, you know, they used whatever was to hand. The vine extends through. It was interesting to see. We've sort of got the cracking, and again, the sort of lime mortars, possibly to fill the joints where the pointing is lost, etc. But being very careful to protect the, and not introduce too much water where there's the polychromy. This is the sort of state that it is in, and you can see it doesn't read well where the canopies have been lost, and it's exposing the sort of open core behind, which was sort of just packed with mortars, with stone to fill voids. It's how to then represent that as well. I mean, at the moment it's stable, you could just point around that rubble core, but will that enable it to be read well in the future? Do you bring it up to a level and find a sympathetic level to maybe put more of a flaunching mortar in? There's different ways to treat it, and it's this is all part of the ongoing debate of the presentation of the whole and the fragments for the future. Again, this is near... What was interesting... Yes, this one... Yeah, the voids against the window at the lintel level, and you could see right into the... behind to see how the Reredos was finished further back. The leaves... There's physical damage from more recently where things have been lent against the framework. So for access, and alternative methods need to be found so as we don't cause any more of this damage of the surface than's already there. This is at high level above the window here. But on the left, you can see what Jerry pointed out, where the return on the north side of the South Reredos would have come round, where the arch now comes in, and it's lost the sort of edge of that, where it would have extended into the transept somewhat to frame the Reredos potentially. So it's sort of left sort of hanging there to some extent. And again, as these sort of empty the voids, the old dowels, a timber dowel to support possibly the it might be early, but it might actually also be to support the partition wall that was put up in front of it as well. And then the radiator is actually doing it no favours and might have contributed to the soiling as well, and the sort of change in heat and the discoloration, especially at low level over the Jesse. The radiator's immediately beneath him, and he's very, very brown when actually you'd expect, dark, but when you'd expect him, when it was first exposed in 1848, that all the statements are that it was gleaming as if it had just been constructed or destroyed, but now he's rather dark. Then we have, very crude pointing repairs done over the years, and where a lot of the detail is filled up with mortar, if you like, on the sort of top right, which is concealing evidence today, and then the sort of the plinth for the statue within the niche, which isn't anything, doesn't represent what it would have looked like, but it gives us a height of where the niche would have been. What did I do there? Oh, we did some sort of opening up of little windows through the lime wash as well, to sort of explore if the polychromy extended into the niches. And again, we did it around the window returns where the red arrows are, to see how the framework might, if it was decorated behind, just to sort of look at the relationship between the window today and the original. Be nice to go a little bit further, but we were a little tentative at this stage without destroying the window too much, because it's quite part and parcel of it at the moment. But this shows that the mouldings were there as far as we went, as well as the polychromy extending into the window returns. Jerry's mason marks, which he can relate back, I believe, to work in the cathedral as well on these ones, or have I just made that bit up?
Do you want me to comment quickly?
Oh, you could, yes, why not?
This particular man not only works on Jesse Reredos, he also works on the arcade of Holy Trinity, the chapel on the opposite side, so that gives us a date for that. He works on the west cloister of the cathedral, which we know isn't finished until after 1480. He then probably goes with the new master mason, William Smith, down to the South Somerset group of towers. He works at Crewkerne, which is a William Smith commission. He also works on the tower at Montacute, and we've just found him on the door to the parlour at Muchelney Abbey, which is part of Thomas Broke's work, 1408-1420. So we can follow his career for about 35 years.
It's fascinating, isn't it? And you get to build up a picture of who actually created this, which is always wonderful. And then there's mason marks that are not just mere scratches that we get carried away with romanticising about, that aren't anything at all, except... this was interesting, but again, not to do with conservation, but just the different hands, potentially, that might have carved this. Just the different leaves. And then again, on the... Yeah, some are sort of very much flatter, more naive, and some are sort of very much more sort of florid and fluid. And then ones where the sort of lower stone doesn't relate to the one above it. It's a, quite a different style of leaf, so a different hand probably carved the lower half, and but it moulds, the vine works perfectly around it. And so it was carefully planned, but people were obviously allowed to put their own little flourishes in there. But there's a lot of paint left on this polychromy, and it's so easy to sort of build up a wonderful picture of what they would have looked like. But it is failing, and they are suffering. And yes, there's the radiator, which I won't mention it again. And dear, poor old Jessie. So I shall let Emma build... No, I'm not allowed to let you. I have to do some fragments too. So again, I think Jerry's actually covered these and the marks on the bottom. And what we've found with the fragments, again, the condition is very much like that of the polychromy on the Reredos. They suffer the same issues in that there's this sort of heavy soiling. They've been kept in, as Judith said at the beginning, they've sort of been moved around. They were stored in the south aisle of the church. They've been in the mason's yard at Wells Cathedral. They've had a checkered history, and they've been put together after their discovery with various materials. And many can be offered up again together, as Jerry has managed to match so many. We only looked at a small handful of all the fragments just to get an idea of the condition, but it would be, yes, lovely to sort of work with the catalogue now to see what can go together. This is salts on the surface that have built up and incrustations that conceal over the paint and the polychromy, which will be causing damage, and that's only from excessive damp, prolonged excessive damp that can contribute to that. These are heavy cement repairs, which are crudely done, and in so many places it's running down over the gilding or over the paintwork, and it would be lovely to remove it. It's very interventive to remove it, and it would be a very long, slow, painstaking process. But it's not impossible. There are lifting paint, which was just ready to be blown off, if you like, and then we've got the white bloom from salts, from atmospheric things that would affect it. Then we've got, this is all very vulnerable, polychromy, but we've got the raised gesso as well, which we took a sample of, which featured on one of the sort of main figures, which was beautiful. So it would have been like an embossed gesso applied over the stone and then the gilding over the top to look sort of like an embroidery. And so just amazing detail. And even the gilding, it wasn't just applied gold, it had paint over the top of it. And then I'm going into Emma's little department there, get carried away. This was the John the Baptist, the camel cloak. And again, the paint is just lifting off of those. They're so vulnerable. So for them not to have to be touched again and having them in store is just fantastic that they've all been recorded and catalogued. So handling now is reduced entirely to preserve that until they can be conserved. This is Margaret of Antioch, the base, her feet, and just there's been light, hardly any cleaning, but just with removing the surface dust, the colour difference, you can see the red and the... Actually, it doesn't look so good, but you could see the green and the black of the wing, far better in reality than this photo. But a dramatic difference just with the lightest of touches there. Again, this is sort of ironwork that's set in the lead and the holes which Jerry's covered. And then...
Yes, I was saying.
Oh,
okay. I'd hoping to go on a bit longer. Coming back to this extraordinary polychromy. When you go into the church, when you first look up at the frameworks, they are amazing, they're beautiful, and yes, you can squint your eyes and think about some of the polychromy, but to be fair, you're faced with what you can see there. And Lynne and I were so privileged to get the opportunity to go up that scaffold and get a much closer look and see that actually, you know, it's extraordinary. You look at some of the intense blues and reds that you can see in those pictures. And again, you've already seen some pictures earlier of that of the Jesse. So up close, and actually when you next go to the church and have a look, do look up again and look in those areas. And you know, your eyes will train themselves and you'll be able to pick out those extraordinary colours. And for the greater part, they are the original colours. There are later repaints, but relatively few from the samples we took. Unfortunately, there's no comparison. I mean, you think of the earlier images that were created when the Reredos were... Sorry, I've just been handed a piece of paper that says 5 minutes. it's better than the winding up. When these paintings, these drawings by Wheatley, were executed shortly after the frameworks were uncovered, and other... there's also this that Dolman had coloured in a drawing, an architectural drawing that he took. He took measurements and he made very clear observations about the Jesse, for example. And they all show a much more vibrant, beautiful polychromy. And, you know, it would have been because if you think about their short history, they were sort of exposed to the elements, to those light levels, for a relatively short period of time, and then they were, in essence, I mean, they were damaged, but they were protected. So at that point, you're seeing them sort of a snapshot of when they were covered over. So the damage that has happened now that we see is since they've been revealed. Down the right-hand edge of that drawing, the little scribble, I've had a bit of go at deciphering, and this is Dolman going back. He went back about 45 years later after he'd done his original documentation. And he's crestfallen because he says that, you know, originally there was this beautiful freshness and brilliancy. But when he went back, he found it more decayed and most of the gilding and colouring sort of obliterated, so he said. So that's even just 45 years. So, you know, you think where we're at now. We took some... samples of paint for cross-section analysis. We took about 100 samples overall, spread across the framework and the fragments. And this is a pretty interventive process, if you think about it. It's valuable medieval polychromy. So we have to be mindful of where we're taking our samples. We want to get a fairly comprehensive picture of what of the schemes would have been. But again, we're taking minute fragments. These were carefully encapsulated in little jelly capsules and given a unique reference and then packaged up and sent off to Catherine Hassel, who did all the actual cross-section analysis work for us. They're examined under a microscope, first of all, and then mounted into little blocks of polyester resin, which is ground down, and it reveals the stratigraphy of all the different layers, the applications of paint layers found through the decades. They're viewed again under a stronger magnification, under visible and UV light, and so forth and so on. It's a very lengthy process to actually eventually produce photomicrographs of the different layers of paint found. From the stone substrate, we've got an original preparatory layer, the ground layers, so to speak. Then you have the original coloured layers, gilding over the top, and then subsequent later paint, and a much later... Catherine suggested it was post-1848, but I have to say there's still a question mark on that. It's very hard to establish, possibly only if samples have been taken from some of the damaged areas, but this wasn't the case. The ground layers on the north... on the south, on the Jesse, were quite sort of red-coloured. They consisted of... iron oxides, reddish, yellow. They're applied in a couple of layers, and it varied wherever you took the sample on the framework to whether you see the sort of deeper red colour coming through or a slightly yellower
surface. They have little inclusions of vermilion and red lead. Even on some of the fragments, it's possible to identify not just from the stone of the fragment, but also the polychromy gave us certain indications because the ground layers were different on both Reredos. On the north, it was a much more buff-coloured ground layer initially, followed by a white upper layers with lead white and chalk mixed, and then quite often a rather pure lead white layer above that, sometimes quite diluted, almost translucent in some samples that we found. I am rushing now. Here we can see that dark buff initial layer, the later white layers, and then the black over the top. That was taken from that lozenge, that line shape that you saw on the shafts earlier. And there you can see where it's slightly more translucent. And that was taken from a fragment. Again, we could therefore say that fragment belonged to the North Reredos because of its ground layers. There's one instance we found where the paint was applied directly to the stone, and that was taken from the soffit of one of the canopy niches. A couple of unusual ground layers. We found a charcoal brown, black beneath the ground, only in a couple of samples. There you can see, and they were taken, interestingly, from the same part of the framework. So one was actually a sample taken from the framework, the other one was a sample taken from a fragment. And of course, when you look at the two, they're very similar, and then you look at the fragments and you go, aha, they are, they're from the same part of the architectural feature. So they both belong to the canopies. So again, you're piecing together the detective story. I am going to nip through a few of these. Three different types of red found. We've got the vermilion, we've got red lead, and we've also got a crimson lake. Crimson was only found in one other sample. It was from a fragment, from that cushion that Jerry had a picture of. I've got a picture of it later, with the Madonna and Child. The green was a verdigris, and that was dissolved. You can see on the left-hand picture there the particles of verdigris. And it's mixed with lead white to make a paler shade of green, and sometimes charcoal to make a darker, deeper shade. It was also used as a glaze, so there were sort of beautiful intricacies of the colour scheme. It wasn't just a flat tone. They used the glazes in different areas to create depth and variation. Blues, and today we might have a few question marks about the blues, but of the sampling that we took, only found on the North Reredos, not on the South. And it was an organic blue, most likely an indigo. Lead white was added to lighten the blue and the charcoal to make it darker, so you got the tonal variations. However, on the Madonna and Child sculpture, we did find azurite. It's the only example that we found. As you probably all know, azurite is an extremely expensive pigment to use and most likely reserved for particularly important spiritual significance, really. And it was found on the Madonna, on her underrobes. Jesse, under a little niche underneath his robe, we found a lovely variation. Didn't find this combination anywhere else. It's a sort of purple. It was a mixture of the vermilion with a bit of black and the lead white. And later repaints were fairly apparent because you can see, again, with this, you've got the original vermilion and then the ground layers above that. And the gilding here, in this instance, applied over a yellow ochre undercoat. The gilding on the Jesse was nearly always applied directly over a yellow underlayer. On the North Reredos, occasionally it was found directly onto the coloured paint. So no ground layer at all, no bowl layer. So although we have all these amazing recipes for how to gild and how to paint, when it comes to it, it's a sort of a bit of a free-for-all. And there's obviously different hands at play. There's the cushion. I will rush through this little bit because just at the end, to bring it all together and to tell you a little bit about
possible future. A lot of grey distemper was found as well over later polychromy, and again, we possibly much, much later, Victorian times, but it seems unusual that given how amazed everybody was with the polychromy when they were first uncovered, that anybody would even conceive of painting it over, but, you know, we don't know. A lot of it has been removed since, so these were often found in little crevices. By the window of the south Reredos, on that return, you can see here where you've got six or eight different layers of lime wash applied, and that would have been part of the decorating of the rest of the church. Are we allowed 2 minutes?
Run through, and then the next the display.
Okay, I will tell you this. Lynne can explain this. A lot of the things to do with displays now are discussed this afternoon. So, okay, we've got some examples of ways of looking at, but I think we can all agree, whatever happened, I'm sorry, I will quite happily answer questions about polychromy afterwards, but this project, for all of us, I mean, we've had our ups and downs, it's been a lot of hard work, everybody has given a lot of time to this, everybody, and but it has been quite a privilege, and it very definitely, I hope you'll agree, is a pretty colourful history. And well, let's just hope that what we've done forms the foundation for a bright future.